Good morning and welcome to worship with All Saints Lutheran Church in Fitchburg, Wisconsin. Whether you regularly worship with us or are finding us today for the first time, we are glad that you are here. Just a couple of notes about our worship together this morning. Everything that you will need will be on the screen, so there's no need to find an online bulletin to be able to follow along. And we will be celebrating the meal of Holy Communion together. And so if you would like to participate in that meal, I encourage you to have some bread or crackers and or wine or juice available so that you can share in that meal with us. After worship today, you are invited to join us for our Zoom coffee hour. You can find that information in the weekly email from All Saints. And if you are not receiving those emails, head to our website and sign up for those. I invite you now to prepare your hearts and minds for worship as we begin with our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who creates us, redeems us, and calls us by name. And all God's people say, Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you and your beloved children. We have turned our faces away from your glory when it did not appear as we expected. We have rejected your word when it made us confront ourselves. We have failed to show hospitality to those you called us to welcome. Accept our repentance for the things we have done and the things we have left undone. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us and lead us that we may bathe in the glory of your Son born among us and reflect your love for all creation. Amen. Rejoice in this good news. In Christ Jesus, your sins are forgiven. You are descendants of the Most High, adopted into the household of Christ and inheritors of eternal life. Live as freed and forgiven children of God. And all God's people say, Amen. Let us pray. Blessed Lord God, you have caused the Holy Scriptures to be written for the nourishment of your people. Grant that we may hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that comforted by your promises, we may embrace and forever hold fast to the hope of eternal life. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And all God's people say, Amen.
This morning's reading is from 1 Corinthians, chapter 12, verses 12 through 31a. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, "Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body," that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, "Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body," that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, "I have no need of you," nor again the head to the feet, "I have no need of you." On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with greater honor, and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our most respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our gospel reading for today comes from the fourth chapter of Luke, beginning at the 14th verse. The Holy Gospel according to Luke. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread throughout all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The first time that I preached at my home church, there were a million different things running through my mind. It was an odd mix of being extra comfortable in that place and in that pulpit that I had often spoken from during youth services, and extra nervous because these people had known me most of my life. Would my preaching on that particular day live up to their expectations? When I stepped into the pulpit, would they still see little Chrissy Neitzel, who used to bring her doll to church in a way that wouldn't allow them to hear the message? And how do I even begin to preach to these people who have brought me up in the faith? When Jesus returned to Nazareth and went to the synagogue where he was raised, he doesn't seem to have any of those same concerns. Instead, he simply stands up, finds the passage he's looking for in Isaiah, and then reads aloud these verses. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Finished reading, he rolls up the scroll and hands it back to the attendant and then returns to his seat. We don't hear much about how everyone in the synagogue responded, at least not yet. Stay tuned for next week for what happens after this. But we're told that all eyes are fixed on Jesus. It's only then, with everyone tuned into him, that he says, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The selected verses from Isaiah that Jesus reads are sometimes referred to as his mission statement. Luke places this story at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, as if to set the tone for all that is to come. And all of it is Spirit-led. If we think about the stories that we have heard and other stories in the Gospel of Luke leading up to this, the Spirit was present in Jesus' baptism. The Spirit then led him to the wilderness where he was tempted, and he is filled with the Spirit, the power of the Spirit, as he returns to Galilee. And our reading for today that he reads from Isaiah starts out, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me." Again, we have this promise of the presence of the Spirit. So in case you had any question, this is what Jesus is here to do, to bring good news to the poor, release to the captive, sight to the blind, freedom to the oppressed. Later, when John the Baptist begins to question whether or not Jesus really is the Messiah and sends his disciples to ask, it is exactly these things that Jesus points out as evidence of who he is. "Go and tell John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, the poor have good news brought to them." This is the work of the Messiah, to bring freedom to us from whatever has us bound. When Jesus says, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing," it didn't mean that all of those things would happen in an instant, but instead that Jesus himself embodied that promise. Jesus came to set us all free. We know all too well, even 2,000 years later, that we will still need to hear these words of promise again and again, because we forget them again and again, and we need to experience anew that freedom from all that binds us. Just as Jesus declared that promise of freedom and recovery had been fulfilled in the hearing of those gathered in the synagogue a couple of thousand years ago, we know that Jesus continues to do that work today. We experience it through confession and forgiveness. We experience it in the bread and wine of communion and in the water and word of baptism. What is keeping you from living the abundant life that Jesus promises? What's holding you captive? Jesus comes to us, embraces us in our brokenness, and grants us freedom from all that binds us. Each time we celebrate a baptism, the parents, sponsors, and the whole congregation make promises to support that newly baptized person in their life of faith so that they may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ in word and deed, care for others in the world God made, and work for justice and peace. That newly baptized person is sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. And then together, all who are gathered will greet that newly baptized with these words: "We welcome you into the body of Christ and into the mission we share. Join us in giving thanks and praise to God and bearing God's creative and redeeming word to all the world." As we gather together with all the baptized, we are granted freedom and new life. And we are also called to be a part of sharing that freedom and a new life with others. We are called to share in God's mission, but we're all gifted by the Spirit in different ways to be a part of helping others experience that freedom that Jesus promises. How are you being called to be a part of God's mission in the world today? How have you been uniquely gifted to be a part of that mission? What are the gifts that you have been given in order to be a part of God's mission in the world to bring freedom and healing and wholeness? Do you have the gift of prayer? If so, how can you best use that gift to bring freedom to others? Are you a great listener? Allowing someone to tell their story can often bring healing and wholeness in powerful ways. Are you good at making people laugh? Joy and laughter can definitely be the best of medicine. The Spirit has gifted each of us in our own way to be a part of God's mission in the world, from the youngest to the oldest among us. None of us can do this work alone, but together and with God's help, we can work for justice and peace in the whole world. Which I think begs the next question. How are we as a faith community being called to be a part of God's mission? And how are we at All Saints uniquely gifted in this time and in this place to engage in God's mission? The answer to that question is going to change over time as the faith community shifts and changes, as the individuals who are a part of this community bring different gifts and passions, and different needs arise in our world. What do you think it looks like for us today? It's one of those things that we will be exploring together this year as a part of our strategic planning process. I'm excited to learn together about where God is leading us. When Jesus read from Isaiah that day in the synagogue, he declared, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." And so I ask, even as we are worshiping from our homes and not gathered in one place, what can we each do today to be a part of that mission? I leave you to ponder this question from Pastor Robert Brearley. What would change in our lives and in our churches if we stood in the pews on Sunday morning, or sat on our couches on Sunday morning, and declared to God and to one another, "God gives us no day other than today to bring good news to the poor, release to the captives, sight to the blind, freedom to the oppressed, and new beginnings to all who have failed." What would it look like if today was the one day we were given to do that work, to be a part of that mission? May our answers to that question draw us more fully into God's mission in this place and throughout the world. Amen.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say.
It is time for the children's message, and so I invite you to especially perk up your ears, children of God of all ages, for this message. I brought a little something with me today. Does anybody know what this is? It's a bandage, right? Have any of you ever had to use one of these? I hope if you did, that it was a while ago and you are all healed, or you are healing well if it's something that happened more recently. We'll get back to the bandage in just a minute, but first I want to talk a little bit about the gospel for today. In our gospel story today, we hear that Jesus has gone back to his home synagogue, to the church, basically, that he grew up in, where people would know all about him from the time that he was super little. And when he does that, he reads some verses from the book of Isaiah. He stands up front, like some of our readers do, and he reads these verses. I want to read them for you from the book of Isaiah, because it's a little bit different than what is written in the Gospel of Luke. So this is what Jesus reads when he stands up and reads in front of all of these people who have known him probably his whole life. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn. Those are some pretty great things that Jesus promises, right? And when he's done saying all those things, he does something super crazy. He says, today, that promise has been fulfilled in your hearing. Now, next week, we'll hear about how all of those people who had known him his whole life reacted to him saying that he was the one who held those promises. But there's part of that reading from Isaiah that I just really love that I want us to think about for a little bit. And it's a part that actually gets missed when Luke quotes those verses. In that reading from Isaiah, Jesus says that he will bind up the brokenhearted. And I think that's such an incredible promise. Because if I were to sprain my wrist or hurt my wrist, I could wrap it up in a bandage until it could heal, right? Or if I cut my finger, I could put a Band-Aid on it until that was able to heal. But if we have broken hearts, there's not really anything we can do about that except just wait for them to heal, right? But Jesus says that he will bind up our hearts. That when our hearts are broken, Jesus is there and Jesus will bring healing to that brokenness in us. Jesus protects us. He promises to comfort us. And so when we are feeling like our hearts are broken, no matter what it might be from, Jesus comes with his own bandage of love and comfort and protection and wraps our hearts in a way that brings them healing. Will you please pray with me? Loving God, we ask that you bind up our brokenheartedness in your love, and that you help us all to heal in the ways that we have been hurt or are still hurting. Continue to wrap us in your love and give us your comfort and your strength. In your name we pray. Amen. And now I invite you all to join me as we profess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance. So we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all that God has made. Gracious God, you reveal yourself to us in the reading of Scripture. Fulfill your word through the faithful witness of your church. Send us out to bring your liberating good news to all people. God of grace, hear our prayer. All creation proclaims your handiwork. Teach us to love the intricate and beautiful bodies that you have created. Bless tiny insects, enormous whales, and every creature in between. Sustain species at risk of extinction. God of grace, hear our prayer. You desire that there be no dissension among us. Where we are divided in our society, nation, or world, come quickly to reunite us into one body. Ease conflict, dispel violence, and bring an end to war. God of grace, hear our prayer. Anoint with your Spirit all who seek your favor. Grant provision and justice for people living in poverty, people living with disability, those living with pain, or those under oppression. Especially we lift to you today, Van, Joe, Judy, Carol, Annie, Amalia, Kurt, Kylie, Jane, and those we name before you now, aloud or silently. God of grace, hear our prayer. Build up the body of Christ in this place. Bless the variety of ministries in this congregation. Empower us to freely welcome and deeply value each person who enters into worship and ministry among us. God of grace, hear our prayer. In thanksgiving, we lift before you the saints for whom the promise of salvation has now been fulfilled. Tend to those who mourn. Bring us together in your everlasting glory. God of grace, hear our prayer. Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all of our prayers to you in confidence and faith through Jesus Christ, our Savior. And all God's people say, Amen. As we gather online, our giving of all that God has given us continues to be a part of how we worship. And so we encourage you to continue to make that part of your worship practice, either by mailing in a check, dropping one off during office hours, or giving online through our website. Thank you for the ways that continues to be a moment of worship for you and as you continue to support the ministry of All Saints. As we give thanks to God for all that God has given us, and as we offer those gifts back to God, I invite you to join me as we pray our offertory prayer together. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, sovereign of the universe. You offer us new beginnings and guide us on our journey. Lead us to your table, nourish us with this heavenly food, and prepare us to carry your love into a hungry world. In the name of Christ, our light. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. "This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Whatever you've done, whatever you've said, wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome at the Lord's table. Come to God's table. There is a place for you, and there is enough for all. This is the body of Christ given for you. And this is the blood of Christ shed for you. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. And all God's people say, Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, gracious God, for we have feasted on the abundance of your house. Send us to proclaim good news and to proclaim your favor to all, strengthened with the richness of your grace, in your Son, Jesus Christ. And all God's people say, Amen. God, who leads you in pathways of righteousness, who rejoices over you, who calls you by name, bless your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. And all God's people say, Amen. Go with Christ into a weary world. Share the good news. Thanks be to God.